Good morning, First Church family. It is a joy to see you in God's house on this beautiful Sunday morning. We're glad all of you are here with us, especially those who are visiting. We ask all of you, whether you're a first-time visitor, a long-time member, or somewhere in between, if you'll sign the registration pad that you find at the end of your row, that we might have a record of your attendance with us on this Lord's Day. We are glad that you're with us. Let me call to your attention a few announcements. First of all, you have an insert in your bulletin. It lists the poinsettias that have been given in honor or in memory of our loved ones, and just to encourage you to look at that at your leisure, and we thank God for those gifts. I want to remind you that at the 11 o'clock service today, the chancel choir will be presenting their cantata entitled The Glory of Christmas, Celebrating Christ's Birth. And I know that they've been working on that for a while, and they sound wonderful. And so if you feel led, we hope you'll stick around and go to the 11 o'clock service and support the choir. Wednesday night supper. Well, we had a wonderful Wednesday night supper, but we're not going to have any more for a few weeks. So we'll just have to wait till the 9th of January for our next one. We'll dream about it in the meantime. But thank you to Miss Dale and her crew for doing so good by us and feeding us so good. You enjoy your time off, and we'll see you on the 9th. Brother Bill, you've got an announcement.
Yes, thank you. If you're anything like me, you don't always get to read the total church bulletin because you're listening to the sermon on a Sunday morning. So I want to put your attention to the blood drive announcement that's in the bulletin Wednesday, this Wednesday, 1 to 6 o'clock, our fellowship hall. Be there. We need your blood. The Red Cross needs your blood. Please. Thank you.
Thank you, Brother Bill. This is a really special time of the year where there's a need for blood. So we hope you'll come out and be a part of the blood drive sponsored by our channel's missional community. I want to remind you that the Christmas Eve services, of the Christmas Eve services here, 5 o'clock we'll have a service in here. I think Brother Drew's getting our young ones ready to present a Christmas play for that, and that'll be wonderful. And then, of course, the traditional candlelight service will be in the sanctuary at 9 o'clock. So we hope you'll come out and be a part of that. I also want to let you know, you may remember reading an article back in the November newsletter about the Call Church General Conference of the Church taking place in February of 2019, dealing with trying to preserve unity in the church in the face of some changes in the Book of Discipline. Accordingly, Brother Stephen and I are going to be leading a study entitled Unafraid and Unashamed. That's based on a book by Will Cantrell. That's the name of the book. And we hope that's going to be a time of prayerful discussion and thought and learning together. We will be providing those who come and be a part of the study a study guide, but if you want to buy the book itself, you can get that through Amazon in both paperback and in Kindle format. If you're interested in being part of that study, if you will, let the church office know so we can make sure we have study guide for you. But we'll let you know about that coming up. That begins on the 2nd of January at 6:30 here in Wesley Hall. Are there other announcements? If not, it's a joy to see you in worship this day. I want to invite the Capehart family to come and light our Advent wreath for this Sunday morning.
Today is the third Sunday of Advent. We will first relight the Isaiah candle, or the candle of hope. Next, we will relight the John the Baptist candle, or the candle of preparation. Today, we will light the candle of one who had a most unique role to play in the Christmas story. Today, we will light the rose candle. This is the Mary candle, or the candle of obedience. When the angel appeared to Mary and told her that not only was she to bear a son, but that her child would be the son of God and Savior of the world. It must have a first seem totally unbelievable, especially since she was a virgin. Yet in her response, we are able to see her obedient nature and her great faith. For she said, "I am the servant of the Lord. May it be me with me according to your word." May Mary be our example as we too put our total trust in God.
Thank you, Capehart family. It is a joy to see you in God's house on this beautiful Sunday morning. Let us stand and unite our hearts and voices in song.
You satisfy. grace as big as the sea, with a voice as big as the sea. Jesus Messiah, name above all names, blessed Redeemer, Emmanuel, the rescue for sin.
Close enough to my mouth? Okay, there it is. I hear it. Welcome, everybody. Is it a good morning this morning? I think it is. I've got another one coming up, maybe. A little scared. That's all right. Well, can anybody tell me what season we're in?
December.
Advent. Advent. Perfect. So we've got this Advent wreath up here that each week we are lighting a specific candle that teaches us a little bit about the Christmas story. But it's not Christmas quite yet. So I thought I could bring everybody, well, don't look right down and speak into the microphone. I brought everybody a couple birds for them. So she passed those around. This one for you, Marquise. And three over this way. Advent is a time when we are waiting to hear about how Jesus, the Messiah, Emmanuel, God with us, came into this world. With that, we get to wait, and we get to hope. We get to prepare our hearts. And I thought I would read to you what happens when we do just that. In Isaiah 40, it says, "Have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not grow faint or weary. His understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the faint and strengthens the powerless. Even the young will faint and be weary, and the young will also fall exhausted. But those who wait and hope for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint." So I brought those little eagles for y'all to balance on your fingers. If you put them beak side down, right on the tip of your finger, they should balance. It's a really cool toy from when I was little. You can tell that toys have really advanced since then. So, can we pray, and then we'll move the wise men a little bit closer to the nativity scene. How's that sound? All right, let us pray. Dear God, we love you so much, and we thank you for this time that we get to wait and prepare our hearts, just like all those long ago waited for you. In your name we pray. Amen. All right. Let's go on over there and grab the wise men. I need three volunteers.
Me.
One, two, and three. All right. So if you grab this one, and Cadence, can you grab that? Need one more. All right, can you grab the last wise man?
Good morning, church. If you've seen me up here before, there's a good chance you've heard me mention the name Andrew Peterson. On December the 5th, me and my wife went to see him perform Behold the Lamb of God. It was the sixth time I've seen the Behold the Lamb of God concert and the 11th time I saw Andrew Peterson. Good friends of ours, Elizabeth and Jonathan Jones, attended the concert with us. It was in Wake Forest, at the old Wake Forest campus. Right outside the concert venue, there is a famous magnolia tree. Jonathan's father passed away earlier this year, and his ashes were spread under that magnolia tree. When he got beneath the tree, my buddy lost it. And I was blessed to be part of that moment. And it was just a really special, precious moment. The Lord continues to bless me with things like that and moments like that, despite my sin nature. I have no aspirations to sing to a concert hall filled with thousands of people like Andrew Peterson did that night. But I do have aspirations of singing an Andrew Peterson song in front of my church. While I was at the concert, I received a CenterPoint text asking me to sing a solo on December the 30th. Well, I come to practice, it's an Andrew Peterson song. God is good. Start here with praises or prayers.
I am here this morning just to praise God and to say thank you to everyone here who has helped and given to the Matthew 25 Coat Ministry. Yes, between Friday and yesterday morning, we served over 100 people here in the fellowship hall. And we are going to Aurora on Monday to distribute there Monday afternoon. So many of you have given new and slightly used coats. And as of this past Tuesday, you have contributed almost $1,200 has been deposited for coats. Thank you again. Praise God. Thank you, God. Thank you, God, for working through you beautiful people.
Right at 41 years ago, right about this time, I experienced the greatest physical pain I've ever had. And that's not a prayer concern, because out of that great physical pain came the greatest joy in my life. And today is his birthday, Dixon's birthday. And just a prayer concern, my mother is in the hospital. We ask for your prayers.
Let's move to the center.
Just want to say that John and I are going to be first-time grandparents in June.
The family of Kathleen Barr, that's Dee Dee's grandmother. She passed away this weekend.
The flowers on the altar this morning are on the altar in memory of my grandmother and grandfather. They were lifetime members of this church. My faith is directly related to my grandmother and my grandfather and what they invested in me as I was growing up. So as grandparents, as expectant grandparents, pour into the life of those grandchildren. Bring them to church every chance you get. Just love them all that you can. It really does make a difference. I think even more than the love of our parents. Thank you.
Yeah, you're right.
Prayers for the Robert Whitley family, Bobby Whitley and his family. Mr. Robert passed away this week.
I would like to ask for praises and prayers for our military and our military families all over the world, especially at this time of year. And also ask your attention to the American flag over here on Dixon's right. I said this last week, but those of you that weren't here, the black ribbon that hangs on the flag here and over in the sanctuary is to, in respect of the president's passing on December 1st, George H.W. Bush. And the flag cannot be lowered to half staff in this position, in this kind of a flag, so the flag represents that mourning for him. It will be there until sunset on December 30th, 30 days for a deceased former president.
If there are no others, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Our Father,
good morning, Saints of First Church. It is a joy to see you this morning. It is good to be seen. From time to time, you may have seen this bright orange ball in the sky. Don't be scared. They tell me that's called the sun. And it's supposed to shine, but I don't believe it none. But anyway, it is a beautiful day and we're together, and that's wonderful. Our text for this day comes to us from the Gospel according to St. Luke. The third chapter, verses 1 to 6. I could actually keep reading to 15, but we'll stop at 6. I invite you, if you have your Bibles with you, to turn there. Or you may look at the screen, but I invite you now to give ear to the reading of the Word of God. In the 15th year of the reign of Tiberius Caesar, Pontius Pilate being governor of Judea, and Herod being tetrarch of Galilee, and his brother Philip, tetrarch of the region of Etruria and Trachonitis, and Licinius, tetrarch of Abilene, and the high priesthood of Annas and Caiaphas, the word of God came to John, the son of Zechariah, in the wilderness. And he went into all the region about the Jordan, preaching a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. As it is written in the book of the words of Isaiah the prophet, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight. Every valley shall be filled, and every mountain and hill shall be brought low, and the crooked shall be made straight, and the rough ways shall be made smooth, and all flesh shall see the salvation of God. Beloved, this is the word of God for the people of God in the house of God. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, thank you for this opportunity to come together in this season of expectation as we remember the words and message of your interesting servant, John the Baptist. Give us grace, Lord, to see beneath the surface to receive the true gift of this text and this season. In your name we pray. Amen. Jane and her sister have been doing a lot of fighting amongst themselves. Their mother told them that Santa was watching them and did not approve of children fighting, but it didn't have much effect. Finally, right about Christmas time, a couple weeks before Christmas, Jane's mother had had enough. Moms, you know what I'm talking about? You reach that point where you have had enough. Well, unknown to Jane, her mother had called her uncle and persuaded him to stand in for Santa. And she said, well, I'll just call Santa and tell him about your misbehavior. So she called Santa, and Santa asked to speak to Jane. Jane got on the phone, and Santa began to explain, I don't like when children fight with each other, and if this bad behavior persists, there will be no presents on Christmas morning. Jane obediently listened, and then she hung the phone up. Her mother looked at her and said, well, what did Santa Claus say to you? With a note of sadness in her voice and a solemn look on her face, Jane said, Santa said that he's not bringing my sister any presents this year. Well, what do you know? Jane thought Santa was talking about her sister, not about Jane. You find that attitude a lot, even in the church, believe it or not. Boy, preacher, you really put it on them this morning. You got those folks today. If folks only really understood that if we are faithful in engaging with the Word of God, all of us come under conviction. And we find ourselves dealing with that this morning in our text. And the bringer of this message is none other then I think one of the best characters of the Advent season, I love John the Baptist. And listen to what he has to say to us. You brood of vipers, who told you to flee from the wrath to come? Can't you see that on a Christmas card? You know, on the front, he's scowling, and you brood of vipers, who told you to flee the wrath to come? You open up and it says, Merry Christmas. Buy a dozen of those and send them out immediately, wouldn't you? Now, who's he talking to? He ain't talking to us, right? Nah. Really? Yeah, he's talking to us. Can you imagine that? Wait a minute. I thought this season was about joy and light and peace. And who let the wet blanket in the house? Maybe it has something to do with his clothing. You know, he wears that old itchy camel's hair. Maybe it's his diet. He's eating locust and wild honey. What if we got him a nice polo shirt and a pair of chinos and gave him a turkey dinner with all the trimmings and some extra collard greens? Maybe that'd straighten him out. We'd get along with him then, but not now. Now he just sort of makes us uncomfortable. He reminds me of another Christmas character from Dr. Seuss's book, The Grinch Who Stole Christmas. And I'm not talking about the nice, cute one that's in the recent movie. I'm talking about the original, mean, old, nasty one voiced by Boris Karloff. That's what's going on. John is a Grinch who's come to steal our Christmas. You think? Are we the Who's down in Whoville to his Grinch? Well, it might look that way, but if you look a little deeper, you'll find out John's not here to steal anything from anybody. What he is here to do is to save Christmas for us by reminding us that we must be prepared to receive the gift of this season and to remind us about the true reason for our celebration and our joy. So I think he gets a bum rap. Let's give a closer look at what John's trying to do for us today. As the herald of the Messiah, his message is pretty clear. He's saying, get ready, get ready, get ready, because salvation is at hand. And that's some pretty good advice. So how do we get ready to receive the joy of this season? Well, John makes it pretty clear to us. We begin by engaging in repentance. We have to repent to receive the joy of the season. And that makes good sense to me. God, after all, is a God of righteousness and justice and holiness. So how could we as sinful people ever hope to prepare ourselves to receive the coming of God into our lives through Jesus unless we are willing to repent? Now, that does not mean that we have to be rebaptized in a physical sense. But what it does mean is that we must allow God's grace to wash away from our lives any sin, any hurtful thoughts, any destructive acts, any ungodly practices that would prevent us from receiving His gift of grace. You see, that's a part of the Christmas message that a lot of people really miss in the season. Beneath all the tinsel and the pretty light is the fact that Almighty God has chosen to invade our time, our space, our lives for the purpose of redeeming a people who are committed to live in a world unbroken by sin. And we need to remember that. There was a story many years ago about two boys in Lake Worth, Florida, who were suspended from school for the strangest reason you ever came across. They were suspended because they ate too much garlic. Stay with me here. They had heard it was good for your blood system, so they ate a half a clove apiece. And they figured if a little bit was good for you, a lot would be great for you. So they got up and ate three or four cloves apiece and then went to school. Well, the teachers and the other students couldn't stand to be around them. Well, they just laughed and kept eating the garlic. Finally, the school officials pulled them aside and said, y'all got to take a few days break. And they asked why. I said, because you stink. And they were indignant. They were incredulous. They said, well, we blew our breath into each other's face and we didn't smell anything garlicky. You know, that's the way a lot of people approach sin in their lives. They engage in these practices and they just keep engaging in them, even though they may be told that it's wrong. After a while, they wallow in it so much, they desensitize themselves. It no longer smells bad to them. And then they're shocked and stunned when somebody calls them to accountability. And that's what John is doing today. He's calling us to accountability. His message is, you've got to get ready and you've got to repent. So what that means is, if there's anything shoddy in your life, if there's anything in your life beneath the dignity of a child of the living God, you got to get rid of it. You have to repent to receive the gift of the season. So Brother John says, get ready by repenting. He also says, get ready by committing yourselves to righteous living. Now, people hear that and they hear repentance and righteous living and they think it's a little redundant, and on the surface it may very well look that way, because repentance certainly involves, real repentance involves a commitment to righteous living, but a lot of people don't have a good grip on what it means to repent. For those folks, repentance means you do some things to the point that you feel really guilty about it, and then you approach the throne of grace and say, I'm sorry, Lord, forgive me, and they're forgiven, and then they go back to the same old life that they lived before and build the guilt up once more and have to come back, ask for forgiveness, and it's sort of a vicious cycle. Well, that's not real repentance. Do you know what the word repentance really means? It means if you're walking in one direction of life, you have to stop and do a 180. Completely different direction. Move away from a life of sin into a life of commitment to God in Jesus Christ. That's what it means to repent. That's what we're called to do. The story told about a woman who lived near a private zoo. One day she called the private zoo to ask the zookeepers for some help. Apparently a skunk had invaded her cellar. And she said, what do I do? The zookeeper said, don't worry about it. Leave your cellar door open and make a trail of breadcrumbs from the steps out into the yard, and the skunk will follow and you'll be out and you'll be fine. A couple of hours later, she called the zoo back up and said, I did everything you told me to do, and I wanted you to know that now there are two skunks in my cellar. It's not enough for us to leave a little trail of breadcrumbs of asking for forgiveness, but continuing to leave the doors of our hearts open to sin in our life. We got to do something different. That's not going to get rid of it. That's going to draw another skunk. We have to do something to change that pattern. We have to begin to walk our lives in a completely different direction, away from brokenness and sin, and into the eternal life God has promised us in Jesus Christ. So John says, yes, you have to repent, but you've also got to change the way you're living. So he tells us to repent. He tells us to change our direction. And it sounds great, but I'm here to tell you, if we try to do that by ourselves under our own strengths, we're going to fail. Because of our frail human nature, we don't have the power or the ability to change those things in us on our own. And that's why John gives us the greatest good news of all in this season. He says you get ready by repenting, you get ready by changing your direction, but most of all, you get ready by being willing to accept the grace of God into your life. We may desire with our heart to be different people, to repent, to change the way we live, but if we try to do it on our own, we're not going to be able to do it. The good news is, though, if we throw ourselves on God's mercy, we will find a boundless supply of grace that will help us to do exactly what what John tells us to do, what we're trying to do, to live the life of a redeemed child of God. One of the perils of being, any preacher's kids in here besides? Okay, couple, there we go. I thought I saw Linda over there. One of the perils of being a preacher's kid or a theological offspring is that sooner or later, you find one of your exploits as part of a sermon illustration. And now that Ingrid's not here, I'm going to take a shot at Ingrid. Love you, baby. When Ingrid was very, very, very small, we were living in Irwin, North Carolina. One evening, we had another ministerial couple over. We cooked supper and had a great time. We were fellowshipping, talking with each other. And then we hit that terrifying moment in the evening. And parents, you know exactly the one I'm talking about. The one where the conversation lulls and you look around and the child is not there and you hear no sound. Uh-oh. So Carrie and I went looking for our bundle of joy and we found her in the laundry room. Now, in her defense, she wanted to help her mama and daddy. And she had seen her mother do the wash many times before. And so she took the jug of bleach and opened it up, poured some in the washer. Well, it just so happened that in the washer was one of Carrie's really pretty black sweaters and a couple of my black clergy shirts. Well, needless to say, the sweater was retired. I think we re-dyed the clergy shirts, but they never were the same again. We laugh about it now. I don't think we laughed that much about it then, but we laugh about it now. But the amazing thing was this. The little spot where some of the bleach had pooled on one of my shirts, it had become just as white as if it had always been that color. It was amazing to me to see that. A little bit of liquid, and that spot was just as white as it had been made that way. That's exactly the good news for us in this Advent season. That the blood of Jesus Christ, this gift of the babe of Bethlehem, cleanses us from all unrighteousness. It takes our lives, our souls that are darkened by sin, and makes them forgivingly as white as snow. God, through Jesus Christ, this gift of Advent, does for us what we can't do for ourselves. He gives us the chance of a new beginning. And that's the real good news of Advent. The good news of Advent is that God in Jesus Christ gives us access to grace and forgiveness of sin. So you see, my old buddy John, I don't know that we want to necessarily sit down with him down here on Main Street, down on Main Street, and eat a meal across from him. He might intimidate us a little bit. But he's not really a Grinch. He's actually come to give us good news. And the good news is this, that if we prepare ourselves through repentance, through change and living into a righteous direction in our lives, if we throw ourselves on God's mercy and receive his grace, then we will receive the greatest gift ever given to humanity. Have you heard his message today? My prayer for you in this season of Advent is that you will hear that message so that you may prepare room in your hearts and lives for that great and glorious gift given to us in Jesus Christ. Thanks be to God. Amen. We find ourselves this morning at this table of love, mercy, and grace. As United Methodists, we believe that this is the table of the Lord. We have neither the right nor the desire to turn anybody away from the table. None of us are worthy of our own merit to even gather the crumbs from this table. But the privilege of coming as a child of the King and taking our place was bought for us at great price. So at the appropriate time, you come as you feel led. What's required is to have a humble and a repentant heart, a desire to actually walk in newness of life and to throw ourselves completely on the mercy of God. So at the appropriate time, come as you feel led. The method we use here is intinction. We'll have a couple of stations here at the front. You'll be invited to take a piece of bread and dip it in the chalice and receive communion, after which you may kneel at the altar for a time of prayer, or you may return to your seats. On that night long ago, as God's gift of grace to us and the babe of Bethlehem prepared to bring about the gift God gives to us in its fullness, through the sacrifice at Calvary, he took a little piece of bread from the table and he gave thanks to God for it, and he broke it and he gave it to his disciples and he said, I want you to take this and eat it. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Then after supper was over, he took a cup from the table, again giving thanks to God for it. And he gave it to the disciples and he said, I want you all to drink this. This is my blood of the new covenant that's been poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sin. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. And so, Lord, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us. As we proclaim the mystery of faith, Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. Lord, we ask that you pour out your blessing upon us here, and all these gifts of bread and wine, make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. We'll ask the praise team and those who've been asked to help serve to come forward first.
Sleeping, who made
Going on until we're together again. May the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you all.
We have.